Powell Prezi format, and hopefully this will be fun for you guys to see. But he's a walking, living, breathing guy who sees opportunity, and he is a testimony also of the fact that he is the first ever clinical program manager for COPD and pneumonia at Vander Boswell. And this is a whole new position and role, hoping to continue to grow and improve how we treat the patients. And today he wants to take our current successes that we had in respiratory and help broaden the scope by bringing them to the administrative role and creating all the new possibilities that that can develop. And Gita, you're shaking your head, you know what I'm talking about. So when he's not doing that, he's working on his golf game, or he's being social and hanging out with his friends. But one thing about him is he is a learner. He's a student, he's 30 years old, he's been learning for 30, and I'm continuing to say as long as he's on the earth, he'll continue to be a student, which will make him a great teacher. And we're hoping that you guys enjoy this. So please help me welcome to the stage, Mr. Tyrone Powell.
Great opportunities. So I'm a sports fan, and huge fan of the old school UCLA Bruins and Queens team, and I'm a big fan of John Wood. And John Wood actually had hope that really, really, really inspired me as far as defining what success truly is. And Mr. Wood actually presented a pretty cool, relaxed conversation as far as what he interpreted success to be. And what he defined success to be was peace of mind through knowing that you gave the complete best and have the self-satisfaction and the awareness of knowing that you provided all efforts to do your best or what you have control of. I think that was really impactful to me with that was, is you typically do something and you said, I did my best, right? But he said that you made an effort to do your best. That means you put in the work. That means you give time. That means you look at the data, you look at opportunities, you collaborate, you have conversations, you use other expertise to find out how together you can make a difference. And that's what really inspired my role. And beyond making it greater, what also inspired my role was understanding the success of respiratory therapy. This is a great group of individuals that are extremely, extremely talented, extremely, extremely smart. But I think sometimes we get tunneled, right? We get tunneled on our respiratory care, we get tunneled on our nebulization, we get tunneled on our blood support, we get tunneled on these clinical aspects of things. Are really doing the success of what we do to be cared for onto the mission and touch lives in a huge, huge way. And hopefully the presentation today will kind of elaborate on some of the things that I've been really, really fortunate and blessed to be in a position to do and some of the change that I've been setting for. So, along with John Wood, there's another great, great author and friend that I had the chance to collaborate with. And his name is Brad Lomnick. And Brad Lomnick was president of an organization called Catalyst. And Catalyst was an organization that had traveled all around the world building up leaders. And that's all he did for this organization. He went from city to state to country, just building up leaders, preparing them for the next step. Removing status quo, moving behind, and going forward. Pushing the limits and seeing where you can go. So when I had a chance to sit down with Brad about 3 years ago, I was doing some work with him, and he was like, you want to turn on my life? Okay. And he was like, there's a few things that really, really make an organization, an operation, or an individual successful. He said there was three key components. And he actually elaborated on this book that he wrote called Triple H, because me and my team talk about all the time, you want to encompass the three nations. You want to be humble, you want to be hungry, you want to hustle. And within this book, he talks about how to change culture and standards. And he said every single organization that he has consulted with, whether it be Google, whether it be Apple, any organization, there was three key things that organization had. They were efficient, they were effective, and they practiced congeniality. Those three things that he said was successful. Now the interesting part was, if you only have two of the three, you meet standard, status quo. You can be efficient, you can be genuine and effective, you can be effective and efficient. You can still have two of those three and be impactful. If you can incorporate all three, that's when you change lives. And this is honestly what I believe respiratory therapy can do. If you continue to broaden the spectrum, and continue to push the limits, kind of share our voices and share our expertise of what we can provide. So here at our squad at Vanna Boswell Medical Center, we started to encompass this EEC methodology. But before we could encompass it, we had to figure out, okay, we can't become effective unless we know what's going on. We can't be congenial unless we have the conversations. We can't be efficient unless we find the gaps. So interesting enough, I had a conversation with a lot of leaders, a lot of individuals from different departments. And we found as far as managing COPD, there's a lot of big gaps. There's so much more than, hey, here's your screen book. Oh, here's your albuterol. You know, don't forget diaphragmatic breathing or slip. You know, there's so much more to that. There's so many things and concerns that individuals have that affect their ability to truly manage their health. You know, what's their socioeconomic status? What's their living condition? Do they have support? There's so many things on so many different levels of other departments that I didn't even realize I had the pleasure and blessing to be exposed to that affect managing your health way beyond what we are typically accustomed to. So before we start incorporating our efficiency, our effectiveness, and our ingenuity, we had to really discover where our gaps are. And that's what we did. And the first thing we did was we tried to understand our effectiveness. And understanding and doing it, past data, looking at situations of those who were readmitted, why they were readmitted. And the interesting fact is, very seldom do most patients become readmitted to a hospital because they did not comply with the medications. A lot of times, it's these things that are beyond the control. So from my understanding, from my way I interpret things, that tells me that I gotta get out of this. You know, my group has to get out of this. Because obviously this, what we're providing, just take your inhalers, stay within this, obviously it's not working. Because people are coming back because of all these other things back. So with that, we came up with some methodologies that will be incorporated for our program. And obviously it comes with a COPD education. I mean, kind of makes sense to start out with COPD education. So what we incorporated, we actually have a product that's provided by our organization. And we actually provided support to our patients that have a very detailed, specific things required to provide their disease process. Everything from understanding the disease process, understanding the natural disease process, a very, very detailed incorporation. But in addition to that, we also incorporated the pulmonary function evaluation. See, a lot of times we give people these treatments, right? We give people their inhalers. But it wasn't a realization to me until we had a lady, a patient, that actually continued to come and continued to readmit. And we were like, well, why is she coming back? You know, we want to provide CPR education so much, right? We want to contain, take your screen, take your inhaler so much, right? Well, it turns out, her peak inspiratory flow rate was less than 30 liters per minute. Does everyone know, actually, it's not really how we have some Boswell here, so let's think about it. Does everyone truly, truly know that for spirema, patients have to have a respiratory drive at least per minute to activate that in their therapy dose? And does everyone else know that that's just for that inhaler? Other inhalers are different. I mean, as you all know, there's so many different inhalers. You really got to twist, you got to pull, you got to delay, you got to do all these crazy things to make them work, right? And have different mechanisms to make them operate. But unless we know that that patient has sufficient functionality to actually drive that therapeutic dose, what are we doing? We provided something, we reiterated something, and in some cases, kind of demean that person saying, why are you coming back? But in all actuality, they didn't have the functionality to provide the device we've been giving them for the past 6 years. So until we start recognizing these things, we don't know what they're doing, we don't know where they're going, we don't know how they're impacting the patient. So what we do, in addition to our CPD education, we provide a peak inspiratory flow rate device to assess where that patient's functionality is. To see, is this truly appropriate for you? Can this therapeutic dose be effective? Now we go a step further. This is not the only step. There's coordination. Do they take their breath in, the lateral flow, turbinal flow, all these things can affect that also. But at the basic level, we need to understand this. The rest can be discussed and talked. You can't predict therapeutic sort of flow. So we have to incorporate that into our COPD education. You have to incorporate that as we have this conversation. When you have that conversation and interaction with the patient, you truly see where you go. The next thing we wanted to incorporate was respiratory therapy autonomy. And we were fortunate enough with the team that we had at Boswell to have providers that really started to support the use of respiratory care algorithms and understand that the respiratory care algorithms really do change the patient's current income state and also change them as far as the outpatient. Because then you're able to have the patient really see what these therapeutic things can do, understand improvement, and hopefully carry that forward. So once we kind of dug into the dirt, we realized that there's actually already a respiratory care algorithm that is in our organization. But we found that job systems were very seldom utilized. And a lot of it is, let's be honest, fear, insecurity about it, worry that's going to increase your efficient loads. There's a lot of things that kind of made it into the void of those things and utilization of it. So what we tried to incorporate was a hyper focused on a respiratory care algorithm. If a patient comes in with COPD, this patient gets this protocol, period. And that is what they're going to get. You're going to communicate, you're going to dialogue, I'm going to utilize your expertise, you're going to utilize my expertise, and as far as the patient's care, while they're here for whatever they say that they need, they will be managed. Because you see this patient true, but y'all see that patient at that facility, you're doing your clinic, I'm here. I see the x-rays every day, I'm having that interaction with that patient 3 or 4 times a day, I'm assessing their breast sounds, I'm looking at these things. Trust me, trust the process, and then you're going to act accordingly. And the interesting thing with that I'm going to share a little bit, is that improving respiratory autonomy, it moved the numbers quickly. It moved the numbers quickly. And a lot of the fear that we thought we had, there was a response to them that actually eased everyone and kind of changed the respect that respiratory had within our organization. The next thing we incorporated was a pharmacy consultation. We, of course, brought us to the education. We talk about the medications, we talk about these things that the patients are getting, which is completely important and very, very valuable. But where the gaps lie is beyond that. So as I kind of mentioned earlier, we did a lot of digging into seeing why are patients returning to the hospital. And what we discovered is a lot of it is drug-to-drug interactions. Patients taking OTCs, over-the-counter medications that are affecting how these things are working. You know, herbal, naturopathic medications are also very, very popular these days. These are things that we do not discuss with our CPA location that affect the patient. A perfect example of this. We had a patient that, once again, was incorporating everything we discussed, everything we were teaching, everything we were providing, and she was complying with it. She took her medication, she started doing the exercises, she started doing et cetera. Well, what we noticed is that when she went home on her prednisone taper dose, which is everyone gets their prednisone taper dose, that's kind of what we do for exacerbations. We didn't know, we analyzed that how that was affecting her potassium and how it was also affecting her glucose. Because one thing we really didn't realize is that how prednisone affects both of those figures. So it's kind of interesting that she came back with weakness and shortness of breath. Huh. It's kind of interesting. That she came back to that. She complied with operations, she complied with what we're giving. But this was something that was very scope. So we definitely want to incorporate the use of pharmacy consultation and empower our pharmacists. We love our pharmacists at that facility because they have done a lot of work and a lot of investigation for us to find where our gaps are. Furthermore, we work with Nikki Murdoch, who is a clinical pharmacist and also a professor at Midwestern University. And she created this great tool that we utilize that we assess when patients return to our hospital. So with this tool, it looks at everything from who their caregiver is, you know, what medications they are on, and how many medications are on, because polypharmacy is a huge, huge concern. And with this tool, we discovered that for COPD patients, the common reason why they come in and become readmitted was because of polypharmacy, too many medications, and also because of insulin and opioids. It's interesting, right? Because we have a patient that can be COPD here, we can have them on the CPAP machine, they're doing what they're supposed to, but then we gave her a dose of opioids to help her sleep at night. So now she's on the CPAP machine, great. And now she's not really breathing. Wow. What a little gap. Let's see what we can do to address that. So it was interesting to kind of discover that the common denominator of those that are coming back was opioids. Without collaboration with our pharmacy team, and without having the abilities to really have the time to focus and hyper-focus on these things, that would have never been discovered. Once again, we would have defined success in our way typically, but we would have defined it off of not giving our best effort. And that's what this is really about. Next, we also incorporated a nutrition consultation. One figure that really wowed me, do some research that they've done with the advocate healthcare system, was that 1 out of every 3 patients coming to hospitals in the United States of America, malnourished, 1 out of 3. 2 out of 3 leave the hospital malnourished. 2 out of 3 leave. How can we expect someone to team them up for success? You said, a team up for success. How can we do that if they're not nourished? How can we expect them to have a good respiratory functionality and drive and heal if they're not nourished? So what we actually incorporated, a hyper-focus on our MST, which is an evaluation that nurses do on a patient health profile that looks at the patient's malnutrition screen test. That's what MST stands for. It looks at their nutrition. And what we started incorporating in our facility is every single patient that scored a 2 or higher automatically gets a 4 nutritional score, period. On the day they're admitted, we discover that patient, we do that MST score. If they are 2 or greater, they get a 4 nutritional score, period, done. In a little bit, I'm also excited to show you how that turned out as well. But we have to discover these things, guys. We have to really, really take the time and to see where the gaps are. And really broaden our scope. And really become innovative. Next, we incorporated a lot of work with our case management and social services. We've got a lot of gaps, guys, to be honest with you. But with the case management and social services, we found out that a lot of patients are leaving the hospital having to choose, do I pay for my Advair or do I keep my life? Do I keep my life? Do I pay for my Spirema or do I get groceries? I'm getting groceries. You know, that's just me. I'm a big fan of the hamburger pies, so if you want some cream, hamburger pie, it might be. I'll be sure to recommend it. But we incorporated, we need to really address this, right? We need to really figure out, okay, what other things are concerning our patients? And what we discovered is there's a lot of community resources that happen. Touch base with your community. Touch base to see what's available. And what we're able to incorporate with our education is actually provide us with the education, but we also ask, what are your concerns? What are your risks? What are your barriers? This is your concern, well, guess what? A mile from your house is a food pantry review. Guess what? You can't be your life, there's this service that can help you as well. You can't make it to your follow-up appointment, that's the reason why you can't even have transportation. If you're a geriatric patient, you don't have the support, you live alone. You can't make it to your follow-up appointment. Well, guess what? There's this community service for you that you actually get a free service. They will pick you up from your home on a 480 level, take you to your appointment, wait for your appointment, bring you back home. Now we've met that patient. Now we're going to do patient-centered care. This is what we all read about, right? Our evidence-based and all these different things. Now we become patient-centered. We didn't throw a blanket. We didn't throw a checkbox. Let's talk to you and have a conversation and figure out what your concerns are. We have it. So that was one of the great things we did. We also increased our follow-up process. So what we did in our program, we provided a little small business to see where the patient's understanding and managing their health lies. So we have a quick, small, 4 questions that we ask the patient as far as managing their health. And we ask them, so hey, do you know what you can do to prevent from becoming short of breath? Then we follow up with another question. Do you have something near rescue you? Do you know what to do or why or when you should call your physician? Are you taking your medication as prescribed? So we incorporate these questions to see, okay, where's the patient at, right? Because then we can truly see, okay, this is where you are. This is where our conversation is going to go. And this is where I'm going to take it. Now we have that tool. You know, now we're able to really interact with the patient to see, okay, where can we get to? Where can we be? And how can I help you really get there? And lastly, we had a lot of work with our community providers. So I have the privilege to meet a lot of our community docs to see where their concerns are. And funny enough, it was interesting to know that statistically out of our COPD population, let's make it easy to say 100% COPD population, as far as pulmonologists seeing these individuals, it's only about 30%. Most of our patients that are COPD are handled by a primary care physician. So we have someone that's a non-specialist taking care of a special disease. Even to this day, honestly, we don't truly have a complete understanding of I mean, after the progressive, trying to risk under the disseminated sale, because active COPD versus not active, you can be a severe COPD here, just throwing the active at the moment in time, and it's like, wow. You know, there's a lot more, in-depth understanding of this disease than we ever understood. So luckily, we were able to communicate with our community providers, and we had this where, okay, look, the patient's gonna leave, we're gonna have this pamphlet, we're gonna have this medication, we're gonna have this COPD action plan that's a very, very clean, easy document that can laminate in front of the refrigerator that has a green zone, a red zone, and a yellow zone. On the left side of the document, has your signs and symptoms. On the right side, it has some actions and support. And you're gonna provide this to this patient, and guess what? I'm hoping that you would come on board and reiterate this. So let's have this conversation. Another thing that was great that we just found out is that out of those that are diagnosed with COPD that see their providers in their setting, about 12% know how to use their inhaler properly. 12%. That's crazy. I was astounded to see that 12% know how to use their device properly. But that's where it comes with extreme ownership, right? Taking accountability. Making the best opportunity you have before to make a difference. So that's not just some of the things that we incorporated in our process. And that helped us to be a little more effective. But now came the efficiency, right? We found the gaps, we found the concerns, we reached out to our community, we reached out to our community providers, we brought a whole team of specialists in to discover the gaps and how we can address them. But now we've got to be efficient. So how are we going to be efficient? Well, there really isn't a true way to identify a COPD patient in the hospital. Unless you walk in, unless you're making a chart, of course, that's what you should be doing anyway, mind you. But there really wasn't a true, fluid, efficient way to do it. So initially, the organization started looking at the chart. Looking at the chart, patient by patient, and discovering, okay, is this patient still here? And you believe it, going through a hospital is 200 beds, 300 beds, 400 beds, 500 beds. Can you imagine going through every single chart, seeing this is COPD? The time takes, it takes hours and hours to do all that. And besides that, you start to make different things. How do I look at length of stay? Well, I look at it today, today's Tuesday. I was looking at length of stay 3 days ago. I'm looking at just the past 24 hours. It makes sense. But the reality is, what measures COPD readmission is based off ICD-10 coding. And the ICD-10 code can be placed at any time during the patient's stay. It can be placed on the first day, second day, third day, up to discharge. And that is actually what is used as a metric to determine what a readmission and readmission is not. So if we're looking at our charts, at length of stay, okay, they've been here for this long or that long, we're not meeting our customer. So luckily, we were able to collaborate with our health information technologies team, and we developed a COPD report. And the COPD report is an auto-generated report that identifies every single COPD patient based off ICD-10 code. Further than that, it actually dives in and pulls information that was actually dialed into the chart documentation. So not only can we look to see if they're a COPD patient, we can also look and see, okay, when did they get readmitted? Were they readmitted in another facility? So our report looked to see, okay, were they readmitted in another facility in the end? Not only that, how many medications are they on? They were here today. We did their pre-inventory program today. Today, it was 32. But what was it last time? So luckily, this report was able to generate their historical treatment story for me. So if they were 40 last time, they're on the screen. They're 35 this time, they're on the screen. Lucky enough, we have a wonderful education squad that addresses that. It's time to have that dialogue and discussion, really changes that. We have a clinical reason, a clinical validation of why we need to change this. The report is also able to see who as part of the consults have been performed. Has pharmacy done their consult? Has nutrition done their consult? Has pulmonary rehab? kind of conversations to promote that program for that patient. So there's a lot of great tools and great people to do this. And the wonderful thing about this is we went from 2 hours a day looking through a chart, able to discover all this information in 3 seconds. Now, coming from a managerial level, you look at productive versus non-productive hours for our employees, right? I got 2 hours of telling me non-productive looking through a chart. Times that by, say, easy numbers, 25, that's $50 a day, times price. Look how much money we spend on non-productive hours. Now we're able to, in seconds, identify the patient, find that patient's gaps, find as far as our program compliance operation, what hasn't been done, and if it hasn't been completed. So that's one of the great things that we work on to become a little bit more efficient. We definitely want to hyper-focus our collaboration with IT. And the gentleman mentioned earlier that my role is not only for COPD, but also for pneumonia. And luckily enough, we're generating a pneumonia report that also looks at, was the respiratory operating in order? Was nutrition consult done? Did this patient receive their vaccine needs? What antibiotics are they on? And this tool as well will help how we manage our patients. Not in discharge, not 6 months later when you actually get the readmission to analyze what happened because our patient's already gone, but at that moment to understand where our patient is. And one of the wonderful things that we're able to incorporate with our IT fellows is making this device available for the entire Banner Health system. This tool is available for any Banner Health system at this moment. And pretty soon, there will be collaboration and work with our heart failure, our stroke, our AMI, and pretty soon breathing. Because when I stepped into this role, I understood that comorbidities, this patient has COPD, but they also have heart failure. Or they might have renal disease. Or they might have suffered from a stroke. So if I am going to address this one concern, knowing that our payers look at, did you come back to the hospital? I don't want to hear what they came back for. Did you come back to the hospital? So we want to make sure that we're attending to the masses, right? We want to make sure we're effective. So I want to make sure that our programming are standardized. We have one voice, we have one product, and we use that product to treat our patient in a patient-centered fashion. So that's one thing I'm really excited about that's coming, is that we're going to look at multiple disease processes. And all this is done through our work with IT. In addition to this, we're able to produce a product that actually, as things are being done and documented, actually flows into an Excel pivot table that actually looks at trends. So I can see for our CPD education, how do we do this? Could it be 90% of our masses? Could it be 40% of our masses? How is our pulmonary console? Could it be 10%, 20%? How are our follow points? Where are we at? Because then you're becoming proactive, right? Then I'm saying, okay, our guys are seeing a trend. We're not getting our own nutrition support. We're not getting any doctors. Let's get the momentum going. Let's actively encourage the changes now. Not wait until later. Let's keep the momentum. Let's keep the influence. Let's change this now. So I really appreciate the IT fellows and their collaboration of making our product very, very efficient. Last is congenital. Now this one was really fortunate for me that when I got to my role, I've been in my role for about almost 4 months now. And I had the opportunity to sit down with my team and to really find out who they are, right? And where their heart at. Let's be honest, some of us got patient care because we want to make a difference because we care. Some of us got to like, hey, it's a secure job. We all have different motives and conditions. So we've got to make sure that even though the results are the same, that we have the appropriate message for the individual. So luckily I was able to meet with all of the team and find out some of the things that were important to them. And actually I have someone here in the audience and they don't know this, but it was kind of like, not like a test, but you know, I was kind of soaking that information so I could find out how to connect with them. And here's some of the common things I was able to discuss with them and find out that impacted them as far as changing lives. A lot of people just want to be kind. They want to be honest with their patients. They want to be themselves. They want to be helpful. They want to be a servant. They want to be conscious. They want to be friendly. They want to be pleasant. They want to have a relationship. So my job as a leader is to now hear what they want and provide that. Give the best of my control, give the best effort that I can now to put them in a position to be successful, to do what helps them and inspires them. So this was a great, great opportunity to beef up our ability to be congenial. Now we're into the fun stuff, now we're into the data, right? Let's see how everything will turn out. So I started my role the end of March, March 28th to be exact. And in January, we had about readmission rate of 20%, which is pretty common to the national average. In February, we dropped about 12.5. We had a small spike at about 15. And at the end of that time, around March, we really started to dig in and have dialogue and discussion. We started to incorporate certain mechanisms into our program. Just with that work alone, and having hyper-focus, and changing our perspective, becoming efficient, becoming effective, practicing congeniality, we're able to drop our remission rates in April to 2.5%. Then we had our COPD report built and executed. We went to about 5% for the next month. 5% for the month of June. In July, and actually I just received data from our CPAI team, our Continuous Process Assessment Improvement team. And so far for July, we had zero readmissions. And so far for August, up to date, we have zero readmissions.
Education begins when the patient walks in, education continues with every encounter,
that sound like when they got their bags ready, you know, they're ready to go home, they're ready to do their meal, and be like, hey, guess what? Can I talk to us some more? No, they're not going to retain that information. Beyond that, how much information can truly be obtained and discharged? Think about it, right? I'm up here talking to you guys now, with the back of my mouth for about 4 years. How much of this information is really going to be obtained? Only a few things. But if we begin the conversation at admission, and continue with as we have our SPNs, continue with our pharmacy techs coming in, our pharmacists coming in, continue with our nutrition reps coming in, continue with case management, continue with pulmonary rehab, now we have repetition and reiteration. More importantly, we have one consistent message. We have one consistent document. Now, see if the action plan is being reiterated. Not only here, we begin addition and continue to discharge, but now our community also has that same message. So I'm very, very excited about it. So for our discharge call performance, our case management social services, about 45% of our patients that are qualified receive a quality appointment at discharge. Now, the only reason I say qualified is, let's be honest, in the healthcare field, right? Unfortunately, not everyone that comes in leaves. Not everyone goes home. Some might get into state of their organization, be there for a few months. But for those that have, that are able to, be able to meet them at discharge, we're able to make sure that 45% of those have. For that, 92% of our patients that had follow-up appointments that are able to have that provided for that discharge, 92% is complied with their physician's appointment. 92% wins. And that is only done through the collaboration with the educators and case management, making sure that patient has the tools they needed to get there. It's different telling someone what you should do. That's different than telling them and how I'm going to help you get there. That's two different things. And as respiratory therapists, we are no longer going to tell them what to do. We're going to tell them how to get there. And we're going to assist them on how to get there. And that's why being patient-centered and getting where they are. Of course, we encourage our physician partnership. It was a great, great tool to help us with this. And as I was talking to a lot of the hospitalists and the pulmonologists and different individuals, I was like, I'm a guy. I was like, hey, let the expert ask for expertise. You know, they kind of kid. And initially they were like, you know, you may be a light fun environment, but then I followed up with the data. Because remember, you have to make the effort, right? The historical. You do your homework. Get that effort, and then you can provide your best. So I wouldn't know, hey, statistically, those that have respiratory algorithm protocols are later stage hands. Statistically, those that have respiratory algorithm protocols recover faster. Statistically, as an organization, as far as meeting our metrics and our margins, patients are more satisfied when they have someone practicing their expertise because who they have the most encounters with, nurses and therapists. So if I'm able to practice my expertise with you, show my value, collaborate with you, it brings forth all the success. Changes lives. So I presented that data to them. And then it becomes transparent, right? It's like, you can do this, can you do that? Where are you gonna be? Before that, I had conversations with the CEO, CMO, our senior ops team, to make sure that everyone understood the correct message. And to make sure we all have one sound vision, one sound goal. And then it becomes one of those things, either you're going to get on ship or... So that's one of the great things that I'll tell our physician partnership. They let the experts exercise their expertise, which is a beautiful thing. So our length of stay. As I mentioned, we kind of came into the middle of the first quarter. Our length of stay, For our first quarter, our length of stay was about 5.01 days was our length of stay. Second quarter, we really started to get the conversations, get the moments, and get the discussions going, see where we are. that's the time where we're fixing things. Tyrone knows our goals to make sure we're good to go. We're about 5.0 in 20 days. In the third quarter of today, we dropped our length of stay for our patient 3.88 days. 3.88 days. That's how long our patients are now in our hospital. And that is awesome. But we understand with medicine, right, things change. This is a current number. It does not change the grind. It does not change the hustle. We are continuing to find opportunities. And with numbers, because let's be honest, things fluctuate. If that comes, we're going to address it appropriately. And we're going to manage it. We're going to collaborate. We're going to have it together to attend to our community. So our pre and post question, I don't know if you guys recall, or our CP educator provided a questionnaire to see how the patient understands managing their health. For question one, patients responded appropriately as far as how to avoid things as far as becoming triple-threat. About 35% of patients answered that correctly. 35% of the 778 patients up to date, well actually that's up to the beginning of August, that come to our facility know how to avoid triggers. After the COPD educators provide education to them, we're about 83%. Admit, we have a conversation, we continue the conversation, with discharge, we have a conversation, and later on, after we leave the hospital, I personally follow up with them, and 83% of those know how to avoid triggers and prevent exacerbation. As far as making sure that patients have respiratory patients and their maintenance patients and know how to use them, about 75% and in the end about 96% of patients now have a firm foundation on how to utilize their therapy medications. Question three, which was, do you know when to call your physician? What triggers, what things can you feel, what symptoms can you feel to know when you should call your doctor or know how to respond? About 39% of those patients understood that prior to COPD education. After COPD education, upon the discharge, 82% of people knew now how to respond and recognize their symptoms and be proactive with their care. So that's amazing. And lastly, are you taking your medication as prescribed? We're at about 78%. But our first encounter with the patient after education, and the work of the great team, right about 98% of people understanding how to use a medication. And overall sum, there's all our scientific data to see if it has significance, right? That's what we're testing. We don't look at things and see a trend and say it's effective. No, we do a scientific analysis. We look at metadata and meta-analysis, and we truly determine, was this scientifically efficient or not? That proved that it was. The p-value proved that it was. So the big fear about more treatments, more work. That is actually completely false if you have a respiratory care protocol that is encompassing your work. For example, the screening numbers, you have 100 patients, all on Q4s, that's about 300 count. That equates, let's say, about 11 therapists. That's about 10 patients of therapists seen per round with an equivalent of 15 minutes per round per patient. If you have a respiratory algorithm incorporating the same value of patients, 100. Let's say 50% of those now have a respiratory algorithm incorporated, which means you evaluate them, you get the hyperventilation going, you get their airway clearance therapy, we're titrating their oxygen, we're doing all the different components that we have mandated control over, we're addressing them daily and incorporating these properly, either discontinuing or providing as the patient's clinical physician presents itself. That includes about, let's take the numbers, a 450 count. But now, remember, our load that we need for the day is the same. We still leave with our certain load. And that's 30 for one facility or 40 for one facility. What happened? That did not change. But we now have a count of 18 therapists. So now, instead of seeing 10 patients per round, that therapist is seeing 6 to 7 patients per round, which equivalents to about an average of about 25, 26 minutes per patient. That's a lot of education. That's a lot of interaction. That's a lot of, okay, let's figure out what's going on. Let's address this. Let's
see where you are. And that's 3 to 4 times a day, depending on where that patient's frequency are. So that's some of the data I'll be share with you guys. Now one thing that was implicit to me that I kind of talked to my leaders and those that blessed me with the opportunity to have this role. I'm truly, truly fortunate. And they asked me in the interview, what are you going to do? This is a completely new role for the American health system. There isn't really any structure. You know, what are you going to do? Behavior, you know, improves. Can't do that. You know, and so what are you going to do? And my role is to create a culture of excellence, education, and accountability. To prioritize the build of respiratory therapy, be innovative, and exercise expertise to be an influential member of the organization. And that is key. We are respiratory therapists, but we are an influential member of the organization. We make a difference. A lot of times we forget the numbers, but if they want to talk numbers, guess what? We can provide numbers to you, we make a difference. Length of stay, readmissions change, return on investment, cost avoidance, increase productivity, make a difference. No matter what your purpose is, it's patient care, we're going to allow you to try to provide true patient care. If it's the metric, guess what? You're going to meet the metrics. Because now that patient feels valued. You're giving them time, you're giving them effort, you know who they are. And we're going to meet our margins. And one thing that's really key to me as well, my interview was cool, and I had a conversation with them, I said, I always try to invest in collaboration. Because if I invest in collaboration, that's going to take me so much farther than me doing it myself. But there's so much more that a team can think of and be innovative and provide that I cannot comprehend myself. So I need you. I need Susie. I need Tara. I need Carol. I need Lauren. I need Celeste. I need Ashley. I need Derek. I need Dave Chang. I need every single individual.